because he's a really good person to pair with a whole bunch of different mothers.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim shares some insights on his recently completed MFA project, a mythic journey simulator with a close relationship between story and system. Plus, the guys chat about some of the games they've been playing recently. Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
All right. Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to podcast number 8. I am Chris, and I'm joined here by Jim.
Hello.
And today, Richard's actually not with us. He's got, I believe, some family stuff going on, and he is preparing for a big conference that's going on this weekend, if I remember correctly. So it's actually just me and Jim here today. We're doing the old two-man podcast.
Yeah, and we're doing something a little different this time. We're coming to you from multiple locations, so hopefully that'll still come through.
Yep, I'm up here still in the Dallas area, and Jim is still down in he's recently down in Houston, temporarily, I believe. Yes.
Yeah, hopefully that's the plan.
Cool. Yep, down in Houston temporarily. So any future podcasts, as long as this is going on, it's probably going to be say me and Richard in the same room, and then Jim calling in through Skype. But we are actually recording separately so that you're not getting the horrible Skype audio that we're hearing right now. We're going to be syncing up our two recordings and post so that we have hopefully close to a regular in the same room sort of podcast, but we will apologize in advance if we say have any weird gaps caused by lag. So can't really help that. Anyway, so I guess what we'll go and get started with here today, Jim, is we're going to talk a little bit about sort of what we've been playing, what we've been doing recently. So what have you been playing? Anything good?
Yes, actually. I recently finished playing Shadowrun Returns. I started that, I believe, earlier in the week. For those that are not familiar with it, it's an isometric role-playing game, kind of similar to Baldur's Gate, Icewind Dale, the original Fallout games.
And it's based on a tabletop game, yeah, the Shadowrun role-playing game?
Yes. Have you ever played the Shadowrun role-playing game?
I haven't, but I've heard a lot about it. I heard that there's kind of an interesting dynamic. I love the sound of the setting, the idea that magic's returned to the world, so it's modern day or kind of like near future, but with orcs and elves and magical spells and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, and it has this real sort of like gritty atmosphere to it. Mm-hmm. I would describe it as cyberpunk, although not everyone does from what I've seen from the community. Uh-huh. But it definitely has that corporations kind of are the government and control everyone's life aspect to it.
And isn't there some sort of mechanic where you can jack into some sort of network or something like that, and there's kind of like a whole like separate world inside the computer or whatever it is?
Yes, and it's called the Matrix.
Oh, is it?
Yes. Yeah. So as far as I know, Shadowrun was the role-playing game came out long before the movie. Uh-huh. So I assume there was some sort of connection there. Also, you're called a Decker when you hack in. Uh-huh. So there's kind of a Blade Runner connection there as well.
Okay. Very nice. And so the Shadowrun Returns, I heard of that and I actually picked it up a while back, but I haven't had a chance to play it. So it's an isometric tactics game. And like, are there kind of any unique mechanics? If you've played Shadowrun, is it close to how the tabletop version plays?
Honestly, I've not played the tabletop version. Okay. I just read about it. I haven't had a chance to.
Gotcha.
But I played an earlier Shadowrun game that was on the Super Nintendo. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I was familiar with it. I think it plays kind of similarly to Fallout Tactics. The focus really is on the way you approach the combat. But I was most surprised by the narrative because it has this murder mystery to it.
Okay.
Essentially, without giving a whole bunch away, at the beginning, you're contacted by one of the people that you used to run with. They're known as runners. You are as well. You kind of take odd jobs for money.
Okay.
And he's dead, and he basically has a dead man switch that triggers whenever he dies, and it sends you a recorded message from him saying, "Oh, I'm dead, and I'm going to pay you all this money that I've given to this lawyer to hold for me if you can find out and bring to justice my killer."
Oh, interesting.
So the whole thing is basically a murder mystery.
Okay.
Yeah, and it it's handled surprisingly well. I didn't really expect to like the story. I thought it was going to be sort of cliche, not that interesting, because of the focus was really more on the action and the gameplay. But I actually ended up enjoying it, even though it's very linear. Mm. I ended up enjoying it.
Cool.
But yeah, mechanically, getting back to that, yeah, there's some interesting, the way they approach character classes is pretty different. For example, one of the classes, the Decker, their focus is on using programs in the Matrix, which are kind of like spells and attacks and summons. So you can only go into the Matrix if you have at least one in-decking skill.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to have like a cyberware enhancement. That's the other thing. They have like these bionic enhancements that are part of the game. But if you use them, they limit your magic.
Okay.
So if you're a spellcaster, you don't really want to wear cyber stuff. But yeah, like you're basically, if you're a Decker, you're not very good in what they call meat space,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know, like the real world.
Right.
But you're really good in the Matrix. So you kind of, if you know that you're going to have to jack into the Matrix, or you can use it to, for example, break into secure places, get a bunch of information, open security doors, that sort of stuff.
Okay.
So it's kind of like a visual world that you can use for hacking purposes, so that it's not just like a line of code or doing a little, what are those little games they usually have in, for example, Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas have those little hacking games.
Oh, right.
Kind of, it's not like that. It's actually very dynamic.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, but so, you're very underpowered in the meat space, actually.
Okay. So
it's kind of annoying in that way.
Very interesting. And so you said there was an expansion that was coming out, and I guess it's also got a pretty strong modding community from what I've heard. Have you had a chance to try any of that yet, or is that on your list of to-dos?
Yeah, it's still on my list. I haven't tried any of the mods yet. There's supposed to be some interesting ones, because you're right, it does have a pretty good community. They recently came out with DLC. That's really more of an expansion, kind of like going back to the old style of an expansion where it was practically a new game just in the same engine.
Right.
So I think it's called, I want to say Dragonfall, and I should probably check on that so I'm not giving false information here.
All right, sounds good.
Yeah, it is called Dragonfall.
And this was a Kickstarter project, right?
Yes.
Cool. So, I mean, I played it very, very briefly, like maybe for 5 minutes, and I got to kind of the first tutorial and decided I wasn't in the mood for it. So I need to revisit it at some point. But my impression was that, it looked like it was really good quality, but it still had kind of a bit of that indie-ness to it, if you know what I mean. What were your impressions kind of the overall presentation, polish, all that sort of stuff?
I think it was consistent. I think that's the most important thing when it comes to presentation in games. I know we talked about that in Strider, the way that the profile pictures weren't really consistent with the rest of the art style.
Right.
Even though there's certainly a budget, it reflects the old isometric feel. So you don't really have to have super high resolution graphics, but or I should say 3D models. It does seem to be using 3D. But the textures are handled pretty well, so it all kind of reflects this kind of watercolorish look to it, along with the neon lights. It's kind of a strange mixture, but I think it works.
Oh, cool!
And the profile pictures actually work in this one. I think they fit the style pretty well.
Very nice.
So yeah, I like the presentation. The music too, I think, is fantastic. Actually, it really gets stuck in your head, even though there's only. They could have stood to make more tracks because it does kind of get repetitive a bit,
uh-huh.
But they are well done.
Very cool. So you mentioned the profile pictures. I recall that there was a bunch of different ones you could select from for your character's avatar.
Yes.
And so it seemed like they had kind of a few. Actually a pretty good selection from what I could tell. You could have male this class, female this class, and then from there was different variations of the same thing. I seem to recall too that there was a way that you can insert your own pictures. Is that right, or am I misremembering that?
That sounds right to me, but I didn't do that myself, so I can't say for 100% sure. I'm pretty sure you can though.
Gotcha. I mean, it sounds like a cool concept, but at the same time, if you're not an artist, either you're borrowing art from a different game, which makes it feel kind of out of place, or you've got this super weird style that just kind of gets stuck into the game out of nowhere. So I think I'd rather personally just stick to either what they provide, or if there was some way, I don't think they do this, to to basically generate a character portrait. It's like you say, like, pick this face, pick this hairstyle, pick these colors, and then you kind of have a slightly more custom one rather than just picking from, you know, like, you know, the 20 that they provide.
Well, I think they provide a pretty good selection, but it doesn't always mesh with the way that your actual character model looks, because there's actually less selection there.
Oh, right. That's a good point.
So you can't actually customize your model. The only thing is that because you're kind of zoomed out in that isometric profile, you don't really get to see close-up view of your character very much.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really an issue.
Right, right.
That's the other thing, too. Whenever they have little... They're not really cutscenes. It's just dialogue options kind of pop up when you're talking to a character. You don't really see that reflected in the 3D world. You just see the profile picture and a bunch of text and then options. I think it's handled well because it does, again, it kind of goes back to that Baldur's Gate, Fallout sort of look and presentation style.
Mm-hmm.
But it might be kind of jarring for people that aren't used to it.
Do you ever find that the dialogue options are actually kind of meaningful? They actually make a difference in the game? Or is it is there kind of a feeling that's just a sort of false choice, kind of add your flavor to your character, but nothing really changes about the mission?
I think there's actually both.
Okay.
There's definitely choices that are clearly about flavor, and no matter what, you're going to continue the story.
Mm-hmm.
But there's others where you can actually approach things differently, and those are the ones that are usually based on either a skill that you have or a stat. Like, for example, if you have the more charisma that you get, you're able to pick, I think they're called etiquettes. Yeah, that's right, etiquettes.
Huh.
So it gives you new options in dialogue. So, for example, if you have the corporate etiquette, then anytime you're speaking to someone that is works for a corporation or a corporate security sometimes, although that might be under security etiquette. But anyway, it gives you like a new choice in dialogue, and you can kind of convince them to do different things so you can avoid... Perhaps you can avoid combat, or you can avoid trying to pay them off and things like that.
No, I like that quite a bit, and it adds a bit more sort of flavor to the characters beyond just the classes. It kind of implies a sort of history of like, oh yeah, I've been around these corporate types a whole bunch. I know how to talk to them. Or if you're more of like, you know, the proper stiff, uptight kind of middle or upper class, you go into the streets, you don't know how to talk to anyone, so you need a party member who, you know, has you know, gang etiquette or whatever else, street etiquette. Kind of for the shadier parts of the society, because imagine that's pretty prevalent in this game.
Yeah, but only your character gets to make those choices.
Oh,
so
okay.
You actually hire... There are certain party members that you get for specific missions, but for the most part, you're hiring your running team, your runners. So it makes it kind of gives that Fallout Tactics feel to it, where you're really controlling your character, and then you have people that you're hiring to be a part of your team for like select missions.
Uh-huh.
So those people, even though they have skills that you can use, for example, if you bring a decker along, they can go into the Matrix and unlock doors for you and stuff like that. But they can't really communicate with someone else. They're not really the ones that are going to be in dialogue. You're still the spokesman for your team.
Okay.
So you kind of, if you want to go that route, you kind of have to give yourself a bunch of charisma, because you unlock more etiquettes as you get more charisma.
Okay.
I didn't do that. I only had one. So all those choices, I saw them, but I wasn't able to select them.
Okay. I almost think, I mean, I can sort of see the appeal there of showing you the choices that you don't have to kind of, in a way, encourage you to be like, oh, hey, if I had this, I could have selected this option, so I should go and learn that. But I almost wonder if it would have been better to not show those options and only reveal what you have, so that, in a way, there's a bit more mystery to it. And in a way, it's kind of... It's pulling the curtain a little bit more, and maybe making things seem more organic and less I don't know, too transparent a system in a video game. I think, I mean, it's not always a bad thing, but I don't tend to like that too much when I can obviously see kind of what's behind the works.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I'm actually not sure how much was being hidden. I know the etiquette choices were there, but. For example, there were choices where once I got a high enough strength value, I started to notice I was getting more options to use my strength to bully people in conversations.
Okay.
And I don't know if that was just a coincidence or if those options were there before but just weren't showing up.
Mm.
So it's possible that there's a little bit being hidden, but then there's also the etiquettes are always being revealed even if you can't click on them. I honestly don't know. I'd have to play through multiple times to know that.
And actually, to that point, you know, actually, I wouldn't be surprised if that is the case. They hide some things and show some others. Showing the etiquettes, for instance, I think would give some people incentive to not just make charisma your dump stat, like so many role players are kind of known to do, both in tabletop and in video games. A lot of people get really sort of combat focused, and it's like, okay, what stats can I really skimp on in order to increase my, you know, my strength and my speed and all that sort of stuff. So I wonder if that was just kind of their way of saying like, hey, charisma really is useful. You should get it. You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I think that's possible because I didn't use charisma at all, and it definitely was my dump stat. I never touched it aside from the default charisma I got at the beginning, which was 2,
mm-hmm.
As a dwarf. So I never really bothered with it, but I could definitely see how it was. It could definitely be a useful stat because there's a lot of things that I think I miss by having low charisma.
Cool. Just out of curiosity, how long does the game take, would you say, to play through the whole campaign?
I wouldn't say more than 10 hours, possibly less.
So if you're willing to sit down with it for a day or two, you can probably sort of blaze through it.
Yeah, I think so. Except you might have a little bit of trouble. I know I played on hard because I wanted a bit of a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting. I played as a physical adept, and they kind of increase their physical attributes. But they're essentially like fighters, but they can increase their physical abilities. So kind of like a monk / fighter kind of hybrid.
Uh-huh.
And they actually seemed overpowered at first, because when I got to around the second or third mission, I was blazing through things, but then not too long after that, it got pretty hard. So I think there's not a whole lot of necessarily class balancing. You kind of have to be very careful who you pick to go on your team so you have a balanced team.
Uh-huh.
And if not, you can get in a lot of trouble. There was definitely some fights later in the game, particularly when you start fighting bugs, without giving too much away. When you start fighting these crazy bugs, it can get pretty tricky.
Okay. And so you said that you hire other runners to help you out with missions. Is there any sort of element of like having people come back? Like you'll see the same person a few different times, and maybe if you do something correctly, they'll be stronger the second time around? Or is it more just like you've got a selection each mission and you just sort of pick whatever you think you want to work with?
You have pretty much the same selection, but different classes and different characters will cost more or less money. And if you actually successfully work with someone related to the storyline, they'll be available to you for cheaper and sometimes for free, although it's pretty rare for them to be free. And they actually do get more powerful, but they get more powerful. It seems like it's sort of timed based on how far you are in the game. So they don't really level up when you're playing with them. They just kind of get better based on where you are in the mission. But you can always pick them unless they die in combat. If they die and they're permanently dead, you can't get them back.
Okay.
You have to pick someone else.
And that's a pretty common feature I've noticed in a lot of these tactical RPGs is permadeath. I know that they do it in Final Fantasy Tactics. Mm-hmm. If a character is down for too many turns, then they go away. Fire Emblem is kind of infamous for it.
It's exactly like Final Fantasy Tactics, actually. They're down for about, I believe it's 3 turns. And if you don't resurrect them within 3 turns, they're dead for good.
Right.
Just like Tactics.
Mm-hmm. Actually, you know, now that I think of it, even, what was it called? XCOM. I haven't played the old school ones, but the newer ones also have permadeath. And mm-hmm. you'll recruit units, and they come in as rookies, and you have to sort of level them up over time. And it's really interesting, I noticed, just from an emergent story perspective, when they get up to a certain level, you know, you have I think colonel is the highest you can have in the field. You'll have a team with, like, you know, maybe one or two colonels and, you know, some other sergeants and stuff like that, some really good, capable people. And then you'll encounter an enemy that you've never seen before and just get totally wiped out. And it's a really interesting experience because it's like, oh, man, if only I had known what was coming, I could have protected my guys better, you know. And then there's this interesting little bit of sort of commander's guilt. And there's also, gameplay-wise, some ramifications in the next few missions because you have to level up people again and you might not be quite as prepared to take on these new harder missions as they come along. So I find that really interesting in these tactics games, strategy games, because they obviously have the short-term single mission tactics, but then sort of the long-term strategy element of I want to make sure that my team is prepared moving forward.
Yeah, I think Shadowrun Returns kind of, it doesn't really have that element of you want to stay attached to a character because you've leveled them up, since they all kind of level up. Mm-hmm. But you do get attached to characters if you use them in missions, because even though they might be the same class and they might cost the same amount of money, they have different skills and different stats and different spells of their spellcasters. So some of them work better for your team dynamic than others. Mm-hmm. And I know I found myself picking certain characters, thinking they were going to be good for my team, and I hated them. They didn't work at all. And then others ended up being essential, and I picked them every time because I found that what they brought to my team was perfect for the setup that I had going.
Cool. Very nice.
So what have you been playing lately?
So Strider was kind of the last big one, and obviously we wrote that roundtable about it. For those of you listening, if you haven't read the roundtable on Strider yet, you should totally go check it out and comment on it. But yeah, so we played that, and then I think on the side, you know, with school getting started recently, I haven't had a ton of time for gaming. I've been playing a bit of Mario Kart 8 with my brother. That's been kind of fun. And I've also been playing a lot of Fire Emblem Awakening again, which I mentioned in my most recent quick thought on replayability, which, yeah, a little aside, I happened to find an article online, I forget who it was by, but basically complaining about replayability and that it wasn't a real word and that it was too vague and we shouldn't be using it. So I apologize for using that word to those of you who find it annoying, but...
It's not a word. It's a term.
It's a term. Yes.
That's how you get around it. It's a term.
Yeah, it's a term. It's slang. We have a ton of slang, and
yeah.
You know, I find it funny too. I mean, I don't want to go too in depth with this, but like when anyone complains, it's like, oh, that's not a real term. It's slang. It's like, but you use slang all the time. You know, like in anything that you do. So anyway, I won't get into that right now. But yeah, so I've been, the Fire Emblem has kind of been the one that's taken most of my time when I have been playing. I mean, Mario Kart's always fun for little stretches, but, you know, it's Mario Kart. It's a simple racing game. And once you've played, as I have, you know, all of the Game Boy Advance one, all of the DS one, all of the Wii version, all of the GameCube version, all of Mario Kart 7, and then all of Mario Kart 8. As fun as it is, it can be very samey, so there's not really, it doesn't feel like there's much to comment on there. Fire Emblem, I mean, it's actually quite related to your Shadowrun stuff, in the sense that it's a tactical game. I already mentioned it a little while ago how, you know, there's that element of the permadeath and how you're trying to work on leveling up your characters over time. There's a little element of the classic Fire Emblem that's kind of gone in this one, depending on how you play it, because they've added all these DLC maps to Awakening, including some ones that are basically just meant to be kind of quick ways to get gold and experience and that sort of stuff and gear.
I don't know. I personally think the way they did that, because there's actually a lot more characters in this one because of all the child units.
Yeah, yeah.
So you kind of, when you get child units, they're usually starting out at level one. So if you want to level them up, you kind of have to have these extra levels.
Yeah.
Aside from just randomly fighting battles, mm-hmm. Which are not as interesting after you do it for the 20th time.
Right, and especially like you said, the uninteresting ones being the kind of the overworld battles that you can run into. You'll find like sort of wandering groups of enemies. You can challenge other players you encounter via Street Pass. So there are plenty of ways to do it without doing that DLC. But the DLC does make it a lot quicker, even though it's extremely redundant. But if you're going to be redundant, you might as well be redundant for 2 hours instead of 10. So, yeah, I guess there is a benefit to that. And I mean, I'll say I use it shamelessly. I spam that mission over and over again. The vegetarian zombies that you kill to get experience.
Yeah, I remember that one. And I think that it's fair because you don't have to do it. You can actually avoid using those units that are low level and just stick with the ones in the main mission, and you can get through the game just fine.
Yep, you can.
So it's still optional.
Mm-hmm. I just remember though, going back to the Fire Emblem 7, which was the first one that was released in the US for the Game Boy Advance. It was essential to plan ahead, essentially, and get the characters you needed to be high level as quickly as you could, because you do only have a limited number of missions. And you find kind of that core group that you try to level up, find people that kind of work for you in your style of strategy. And I remember my first time through, I didn't level up my lords enough. And so the second time through, it was like my highest priority to make sure the Lord's always got the dibs as far as like, you know, killing strokes and stuff like that to get the most experience possible, so that by the end they were totally maxed out, and when it's time to fight the final boss, you're more prepared to do that.
You still have to do that in Awakening for the highest difficulties, because especially wasn't the highest one called Insanity or Insane?
Lunatic. And then right. There's also Lunatic Plus if you beat it and want to have an even harder experience.
Oh God, I'm not going to try that.
Yeah,
Lunatic's hard enough.
Yeah,
but yeah, you do have to actually plan out. Normally, what you have to do on Lunatic is you have to plan out the right pairing for your children,
mm-hmm.
and then make sure they get the right skills,
right.
and then level them up usually twice using second seals,
mm-hmm.
so you can level them with multiple lower classes before doing their advanced classes. And if you don't do that, you really can't win against some of the higher in the higher missions.
Yep. And of course, they've also added the second seals. I'm not sure if that's new to this game or if it's been around before. But you know, the master seals are the ones that promote you to the advanced class from the basic class. Whereas second seals can actually let you change classes even if you're in an advanced class. So that's kind of nice. For instance, you can use that to with a character as a basic class. If you don't like what class they are to start with, you can actually have them change. And there are still limitations as far as, like, you know, this character can only be, like, you know, these three base classes, which means they can only be these, you know, six advanced classes. So it's not like it's totally open, except for a few characters that have more options. But it's kind of nice to be able to tweak with that and kind of come up with a configuration that works best for you and for the child units, like you mentioned.
Yeah, from what I remember, for Fire Emblem and switching classes, and I just looked it up to confirm, they actually started doing that when they did the remake of the very first Fire Emblem.
Oh, okay.
For the DS, it's known as Shadow Dragon. When they did the remake, I don't know if you played it. I played that one. I never played the first one.
Yeah, I've never played the first one. I actually have Shadow Dragon sitting around somewhere, but I never quite got around to it, which is...
It's pretty good.
Yeah, it's surprising to me, given how big a fan I am. So,
but yeah, they allow you to do reclassing.
Okay.
So that was actually kind of where it started. Then there was a different one on the DS that I didn't play. I never played. That I don't think has ever even come to the US.
Oh,
and
really?
And it's another remake. And I'm looking at it right now. It is a remake of the third game.
Oh, okay.
And it also has the class swapping in it.
Okay. I do know. I think the first instance of any class branching was in Sacred Stones for the Game Boy Advance, where when you did go to your advanced class, you had the option to pick, like, say, for instance, if you were a knight, the really heavy tank units.
Right.
You could either go general, which is an even heavier version of the knight, or you can go great knight, which is a horseback, heavier armor than the paladin advanced class, which comes from the cavalier. Or some interesting options there for you know, branching classes. And then the reclassing, I think, really adds another layer of depth to that as far as trying to decide how you want to build your team, which I think is kind of cool.
Yeah, I both like the reclassing and hate it. And I hate it because I always want to make my characters perfect.
Yes.
So I always want to get them the right combination of skills.
Uh-huh.
And I got to be honest, I've probably sunk about 100 hours in the Fire Emblem Awakening.
Mm-hmm.
And I still haven't beaten it because I'll do a whole bunch of swapping around trying to get the perfect characters with the right skills.
Right.
And
right.
I'll get really far, and then eventually it's just too much.
You just burn out.
Yeah, and I'll put it down, and then I'll pick it back up, and I'll think, well, I might as well start all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And I've done that like three times.
Nice. Yeah, I've probably poured about the same number of hours into it, but it was because I was, excuse me, I played through once and then played through a second time, and now, like I said, I'm on my third run. And it's interesting too, because you know, I mentioned in my quick thought the perfectionist thing. Part of it is that you're kind of curious to see what combinations of parents and children you can get and that sort of thing. And you know, to try most of them out, there's some, like, a whole bunch of equally good ones. And so you kind of get some of the completionist in you coming out as well, where you want to see, like, oh, what happens if I put these two together, and, like, you know, what skills can I get on this person and that sort of deal. So I think I've got at least one more run in me after this one, just to kind of see some more of those elements. But yeah, it's lots of good content in that game, lots of good replay value.
Yeah, I completely agree. I love that aspect to it, that you can sort of mix and match, and you can, even though they're essentially the same character, for the most part, the child units,
yeah,
they have different skills and they operate differently depending on who their parents are.
Exactly.
That's a really cool thing.
And, you know, there's some interesting little things you can take into mind, too, because the classes that the children can be are based entirely on the classes that the parents could be. So, for instance, you go with kind of a, you know, what seems like it'd be like kind of a natural pairing. I think it was Sully and Stahl, like the two cavaliers that you have, the horseback units. In the early chapters, it's like, oh, they're both on horseback. They're both, you know, I'm always sending them, you know, up the front and stuff like that in battle, so they're always nearby each other. So they're not a bad pairing inherently, but then the children are very limited in what they can become because it's basically the class that they're born with, so to speak, which is never going to change, but then also what the parents are able to be. And so if you have two cavaliers, it's basically just going to be, well, all the horseback units and nothing else.
True. Although there are some female-only classes that are really good.
Yes.
So you have that element, too, to consider.
Yep. And actually, that's one of the fun things, too, about the children is if you play your cards right, you can have a female-only skill be given to a male character and vice versa. So Gale Force is one of my favorites that comes from the Dark Flyer, I believe. It's basically the magic and lance wielding Pegasus Knight advanced class. And they, at level 15, they get Gale Force, which means that if you kill an enemy with an attack, then you get another action, which is really awesome. So if you have a unit that has Gale Force and it's really good with, say, critical hits, you can just have them really take out enemies really quickly.
Yeah, it's a really great skill. The other thing that I like, the other character that I like, rather, Donald, who gets, because he has that skill, I think it's called Aptitude.
I think you're right, he gets
he gets more stat points.
Yep.
Yeah, so that skill is so freaking good as you level him up, especially if you, like, reclass him a couple of times. He has, like, ridiculous stats towards the end, and you just kind of class him as a hero, especially if you pair him with someone, with a female that has Gale Force, and you give Gale Force to the kid. It gets pretty ridiculous.
Yeah. Something I want to try out at some point, actually, speaking of that aptitude skill, because he's a really good person to pair with a whole bunch of different mothers, because then you can pass that down to the child. And the children tend to have better growth rates anyway, but then with aptitude and on top of that, it gets just insane. But it turns out that one of the best units in the game, potentially, depending on how you play your cards, is actually the player character's child. So if you're playing as the male avatar, it's going to be a girl. If you're playing as the female avatar, it's going to be a boy.
Morgan, right?
Yes, Morgan, that's correct. So what I was thinking I could try to do is... a traditional pairing for me is Donald and I think it's Noe, the dragon girl, the one who can transform. And then they have a child, and that's Gnaw, which is another Maneki, the transforming dragon. And so she's got really good growth rates, both because she's a Maneki and because it's got Donald's aptitude. But then if you wait with your player character, you can have the male potentially marry Gnaw. And then Morgan's character, Morgan, can have aptitude as well as, like, all those other superior growth rates. So pretty much you'd have the most powerful character ever, potentially. So I need to try that one out.
Yeah, that's actually a pretty good idea. I didn't actually try that, but that's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we can go ahead and move on. So I was thinking we could talk a little bit about your... MFA project that you just finished recently. Congratulations, by the way, on graduating. I think we already congratulated you on that on a previous episode, but it doesn't hurt to say it again.
Thank you.
So your project, actually, and I'll let you describe it yourself here in just a minute, reminded me a lot of King of Dragons Pass, in the sense that you kind of have a prelude where you sort of talk about what your clan's history was, your people's history. And then that sort of affects your beginning stats and some other story elements moving forward. So how about you tell us a little bit about what your concept was and what it was you're trying to accomplish with the project?
Okay, well, I just call it Pilgrimage because that's sort of your mission in the game. And it's supposed to put you in control of an Indo-European clan, essentially in sort of a Bronze Age environment. And you're in this land with gods and monsters, and sort of a land where like myths and legends are still real. The concept is that you've been sort of shoved out of your homeland because you've angered the gods, and now you have to find a new homeland, which I'm generally speaking, I was calling Erhaimon, which is sort of supposed to be this, I forget the term for it, but it's supposed to be this sort of like originating society of Indo-European peoples.
Okay.
That's supposed to be, I want to say it was in like Croatia, I'm trying to, somewhere around that area, like Eastern Europe.
Okay.
Type region, around the Caspian Sea, mm-hmm. if I remember right.
So it sounds to me like you're almost going kind of for a Tolkien-esque sort of alternate mythology in a sense.
Yes.
Kind of like a mythology that could theoretically have led to our modern history, but it's your creation instead of an existing mythology.
Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of the way I built the world. And I spent a semester building the backstory and coming up with concepts related to the world and the people and the different gods. The game itself, and I did a lot of the background to it and wrote in a lot of the design of it in my first semester for the project. And essentially you use turn-based mechanics that are tied to four seasons, and your player has to manage resources and social hierarchies and defenses and religious practices. The religious practices part actually doesn't come up much in the concept demo aside from in certain story parts. But essentially you have to make these small, meaningful decisions that shape the culture of your clan and eventually your civilization.
Okay.
And you make these choices in what I call story interludes, and this is where I was certainly influenced by playing King of Dragon Pass when I was doing research for how I was going to do this. The original concept was actually based on Choose Your Own Adventure books, where you kind of read a few paragraphs and then that explains some sort of situation that your character is in, or in this case, your clan, in my case.
Uh-huh.
And then you're presented with multiple options for how you're going to proceed. These options, though, are only going to show up if you have the right skills and abilities that of your clansmen. Your clansmen are essentially your party,
okay.
you can say, mm-hmm. for an RPG perspective. And they each have different skills and levels of those skills. So, for example, if you have the piety skill, you can do things like pray to the gods for to come down and help you. And I know you can, for example, with Boon in particular, you can pray that the gods will smite a foe for you.
Okay.
And if you do it right, you can do things like have lightning strike a dragon and kill it inside of its cave. Is one of the things that you can do.
Huh, nice.
But you have to have a high enough boon skill. The gods kind of have to like you. And there's this element of gods that like you and dislike you and faction and that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
Which also kind of shapes your society. And then at the very end, once you get through the entire game, and the whole thing is meant to be a concept demo of the whole process. So there is a beginning, a prelude section, there is an ending. The middle part, there is an ending. So once you get to the ending, choices that you made along the way will be sort of replayed to you, like reintroduced in text form, to kind of say how this shapes both the region itself, the region of Erhaimon, and also your people.
Okay.
So it gives you this kind of, if you play, they do this in, for example, Fallout, if you played the original Fallout games, I know the new ones kind of do that too, where at the very end it says something like, if you helped a certain group of people, it'll say, so-and-so group of people continue to flourish, blah, 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 that sort of thing. But if you destroyed them, it'll say something different.
Uh-huh.
So it's kind of that concept.
So epilogue text. I know they did that in Dragon Age Origins, among others, where they would talk about, did you ever play Dragon Age Origins?
Yes.
So you remember then the part where you're in the dwarf city and you're trying to, you basically play a part in deciding who the next king's going to be. Mm-hmm. And so I remember, for instance, it will tell you at the end that this king went on to, you know, rule like this and either was appreciated or not appreciated, that sort of thing. And so it's interesting because you played a part in kind of determining what was going to happen, but then you didn't actually have much control over what that led to, which I thought was kind of interesting. So the epilogue text is also kind of a way to say hey, this choice she made, this is how it all kind of panned out. So that's always kind of interested me.
It's kind of similar to that, and other games do that too, because what I wanted to do with the choices that you make is that sometimes a choice that might be really good for the short-term success of your people, for example, if they're starving, you might have to steal from, say, another clan, possibly even go to war with them in order to get enough food so that you can survive. But that might actually sort of give you this warfare trait that could give you what, from your perspective, might be a bad ending for your civilization. I really wanted to go for there's not really a good or a bad ending. It just, you arrive and then here's kind of what happens.
Right.
So it's kind of all up to your perspective.
Mm-hmm.
But there's definitely some endings that are better than others. For example, throughout your journey, there's more than a few little story interludes that introduce the concept of slavery, and you have the option of taking slaves and keeping slaves or not.
Mm-hmm.
And depending on that choice, that's one of the choices that gives you a slightly different ending. And your plan can either be, if you continually sort of refuse to keep slaves or free them when you're approached with slaves, you kind of become this clan that sort of champions emancipation and becomes one of the first that refuses to have slaves and helps other people or other peoples in Erhaimat sort of abandon that practice entirely.
Uh-huh.
But the reverse can also happen, where your people are sort of like cling on to the old ways and the old traditions of slavery, and you can sort of like force it on other people within the region.
Mm-hmm.
So even though you might get to the end, maybe you feel like you had to keep slaves, or possibly because they can help your production, maybe you don't have enough people to grow crops,
right,
or gather food or go hunting, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So you feel like you have to do it, and maybe it works for you in the short term, but in the long term you might get to the ending and think, oh well, I didn't really want to do that.
Yeah, it affects your legacy. And it sounds like you're doing something kind of cool where your story decisions very directly affect your gameplay, and the gameplay might very well affect your story decisions because of, like you said, things like if your population is too small and you don't have enough production, you might make a choice that you might not otherwise make, which I think is a cool way to approach games and narrative, because the gameplay and the narrative tie together in a way that you can't really get with other media.
Yeah, exactly. And that was the concept. That was the approach I was going for. There were certainly some things that I had to cut. I would have liked it to be a lot longer of an experience. There's definitely, I would definitely like to have more triggered story events.
Mm-hmm.
Or story interludes, as in ones that sort of trigger based on previous story interludes. I have a few of those implemented, but I wasn't able to get as many as I'd like. I have about a total of 20 different interludes, but some of them are triggered, so I think you can only see about 10 or so before the ending interlude, the ending sort of quest, kicks in.
Okay.
But part of that is because I only had one semester to actually develop the game,
yeah,
build it in Unity.
Mm-hmm.
So even though I did planning beforehand for one semester, actually building it in Unity, of course, takes time.
Yeah.
So.
And I mean, anything where, you know, we talk about how we'd love to have a ton of content and have a ton of, like you mentioned, you wanted to include more of the interludes that are triggered by other previous decisions. But of course, the more of that sort of thing you have, the more time it takes to make it. One, because you have to implement it, but also because you have to actually create said content. You have to write it out. You have to plan for how this is going to affect this and all that sort of stuff. So, it's interesting trying to come up with kind of branching narratives, because either you have to really brute force it, which if you have a big enough team and you have the time, is, you know, a perfectly valid way to do it if you're willing to sort of you know, deal with whatever expense that might be, whether it's time or money or both, or you can try to sort of procedurally do things, which we're young enough right now and it's early enough in the sort of the process of doing procedural narratives in games that I've mentioned this before on, I think, our first podcast, how a lot of times I feel like procedural games feel kind of empty. You kind of get a few nice little emergent moments from the gameplay, and you have sort of some interesting things come out of the procedurality. But it can be kind of bland, especially on repeat playthroughs. You sort of realize that it's all pretty generic and interchangeable. And so it's an interesting balance to try to strike there.
Yeah, I kind of I wanted it to feel as though it was more random and procedural, but I really did brute force it for the most part. Mm-hmm. I wanted it, aside from there being a random element to actually selecting which interlude you get, mm-hmm. I want it to feel like it's a personal experience when you go through it.
Right.
So I really didn't want it to have that empty feeling. And I think it was successful at that. Mm-hmm. From the people that have played it, they've told me that it was. But I think it kind of depends also on how you play and how engrossed you get into actually reading through all of the text, because some of the choices definitely have a lot of text to them. Mm-hmm. And even though I say there's only about 20 interludes, each one doesn't just have one choice. It usually has, you make a choice, there's more text, and it says, do you want to do blah, 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 more text. Sometimes there's several different choices, like, you know, 5-6 choices within one interlude. So it's not just one and you're done.
Right.
So there's actually a lot of reading. You kind of have to, you have to like reading to play through it.
I noticed too in the little bit that I played through, and I realized that this is probably in large part because you were on a really strict schedule, and I think you were right for focusing on the writing and kind of the design and that sort of stuff. But I found that I got tired pretty quickly of that same looping soundtrack.
Yeah.
And there was, as far as I'm aware, there was only like one image. Did you have multiple mm-hmm. illustrations, or was it just that one?
I really just had the one, uh-huh. and it was a time constraint. And even that one, I actually used that. That wasn't my image either. I sourced it in the credits. Same thing with the music.
Right, right.
But I didn't have time to go in and make different music for different interludes and different images for different interludes. And that's something that I would like to add. Mm-hmm. But if I was going to do that, originally I was considering just getting various pictures from different locations. And I thought I kind of nixed that because I figured if I'm going to actually have unique images and unique music, I'd like to use original content just, you know, take from others. So I kind of nixed that idea. Mm-hmm. If I was going to go forward with the project, I certainly would, that would be kind of essential because it is important to have, also a nice visual look to kind of build it as sort of a storybook feeling.
Yeah.
Right now you have to use a lot of your imagination. I know I've played it through multiple times, and most of the time I play through it on mute. I think the music is okay, at least to kind of set the mood initially, but you're right, it gets very repetitive.
Right, right. Yeah, so I mean, with the illustrations, I noticed, I agree with you that if you were to move forward, it probably would be a really good idea to have more illustrations, because if you're doing a lot of reading, you at least like there to be some variance as far as, you know, the music and the sound go, and the visuals, even, you know, those visual novel games that are out there. If you find any that have too few illustrations, it really does become just super redundant. You start to wonder, why is this a game and not just a book? And of course with you it's different because it's not just a visual novel. There's mechanical elements of choice and you know, some simulation happening as far as you know, your population growing and shrinking and what resources you have and how that affects your decisions, and how your decisions affect those resources. So there is a gamey element to it, but it would be the engagement factor would probably go up quite a bit. But like you said, it was a demo and you had time constraints. So I think what you've done with that alone actually was pretty impressive. So good job.
Thanks. I mean, one semester to actually do all of the actual developing work, it's a lot. Even though I had most of it written out beforehand in the first semester in the design process, actually making it in Unity is a different process.
Yeah.
So it really wasn't realistic to also expect to have unique images, unique music, especially since I can't really draw, so I'd have to probably get someone else to do those images.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat.
No one really stepped forward. And for the music, I could have made different soundscapes, but I have to download various sounds and then sort of build like a soundscape for each room.
Right.
And that would just be very time consuming. I mean, I could do it because I've done that sort of stuff before. But it would be very time consuming to say, for the forest scene, make a soundscape for the forest that makes sense and possibly have some sort of ambient music in the background.
Uh-huh.
It would just be very time consuming to do that for everyone. Of course, it's essential if it was actually going to be a complete game.
Yeah, definitely.
But in one semester, it's not feasible.
Right. And especially because, you know, the focus of the project was the design element, and focusing on that narrative gameplay, relationship. Another thing I noticed, actually, and this might have been another thing, like you said, you might have liked to include more interludes and more things that would react to the player's decisions. I noticed in the prelude that a few times I felt almost like it was ignoring me to an extent, and like this isn't a huge criticism. I think it was fine, but I found that I mentioned a few times that like I sided with this god on this thing, and then when this happened, this god came to help us. And so I understand that over time, a people can sort of change such that like I might have picked three different gods to be loyal to throughout my history. But it might have been interesting as well to have even some more branching within the prelude questionnaire to say, like, because I made this choice here, I had a different path through the prelude questionnaire than I might from someone who picked a different choice. Did you do anything like that, or was basically just a straight up, here are my 10 questions, and that's going to affect the gameplay?
I kind of wanted to have branching prelude, but I ended up nixing that idea. There actually is branching in terms of choices that you pick and in the actual game itself once you get past the prelude. But in the prelude, I wanted to establish the beginnings so that everyone kind of starts from the same point, and it does influence some of your starting stats, including your the main thing being your council members and also your faction with the gods.
Right.
What you experience with the different, like one god helping you at one point, even though earlier you had maybe done something for another, that's because each option within the prelude, it's running behind the scenes, but mm-hmm. each option in the prelude is giving you either positive or negative faction to every single god.
Okay.
Sometimes it's not everyone, but they are giving you faction to various gods. So you may not have even realized it, but even though you might have, say, helped out one earlier or sided with one earlier, you might have actually pissed him off by doing something that seems non-related.
Okay.
And really, what I wanted people to get from the first part, which is why it would have been too much work to do the branching, is I wanted to make sure they understood the lore of the world enough to play the game,
right,
to kind of get them in the right mindset for the game mm-hmm. Itself. And so if I had done branching, there's a possibility they would have missed out on something very important, very crucial to building that lore,
right.
And sort of different encounters with the gods. Now, there are some things that change in the choices. For example, which god can help you is going to change based on your faction. Like, certain things like that will change. Things like names of different... Oh, jeez. I know what it is. There's actually a few different choices within the prelude that only show up if you've made choices earlier. But there's not as much of that as I would have liked.
Okay. So it's something then that you might have expanded on again if this was a longer project, but for the vertical slice sort of demo, just to keep it simple, which I can respect that. And even then, like I mentioned, those places where I felt like I was kind of being quote-unquote ignored as far as the decisions I made earlier, in the sense that it is, a history of your people, it's definitely very plausible that, different things would have happened at different times, because I'm sure there's a lot more happening behind the scenes in between each of these different choices than just what you're mm-hmm. seeing in the set choices. So,
also, you have to be a little careful depending on how you read through it, because a god's name is mentioned, that doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to gain faction if you select that choice. Mm-hmm. Sometimes what you're doing pisses them off.
Yeah, yeah.
So you have to kind of read between the lines and see, maybe, I believe it's Arenta. Maybe Arenta doesn't want me spying on her and learning her secrets about the stars,
mm-hmm.
But you might think on first glance, but I'm actually, I'm showing a dedication to stars. Maybe she'll like me. So
there's
a little bit to it that you kind of have to kind of read and think, what would this sort of people, and that's supposed to teach you that too, as you go through, she didn't help me earlier, even though I thought I was picking her choices. Well, maybe I pissed her off. Maybe that's how you piss her off.
Right. Cool.
Yep.
So I'm curious too, what sort of, were there any kind of challenges you encountered during the, not so much the design, but the development process that kind of made you change some of your design decisions? Or was it more just kind of like a problem came up and it was just a matter of troubleshooting to get around it?
Most of the time I was able to troubleshoot. I know I had a lot of trouble when I was doing, I implemented a bartering system for when you're, during the story interludes, you can run across merchants or settled clans, settled tribes, and you can trade some of your resources for some of their resources.
Mm-hmm.
And actually programming the barter system turned out to be a real pain because it's a lot when you don't have a standard currency, if you're just saying two cows is worth eight crops or whatever it was, I forget the whole conversion rate. There's no real standard. Everything is worth multiples of everything else. So the way that you have to actually work that programmatically actually was pretty complicated, at least for me, because I didn't know how to do it at first. Mm-hmm. It took me a while to figure that out, and I had to do a lot of troubleshooting. Things that I cut were really just more branching, because there was a lot more that I wanted to have, especially within story interludes. It might not seem like that much, but when you're playing through, say, one story interlude and you have multiple choices, each of those takes a lot of effort to get them to function the way that they are, mm-hmm. and make sure that you're not, you're only getting choices that make sense based on the skills that your clan has. Even though I included some false choice on purpose, uh-huh. but in the sense that if you have like one skill in something and you need like say three skill to get it to actually have it be a success, you'll still get that option. And if you click on it, you'll just lose.
Right, right.
So you are kind of expected to check. Yeah. The other thing too is I actually kind of wanted to have a way to go back and look at your clan stats without actually having to return to the main screen each time. Mm-hmm. So that if you're in the middle of an interlude, you can kind of see, my clan members are so-and-so and they have this skill. I kind of had to nix that idea because I couldn't figure out how to get it to work in a timely fashion. I kind of figured, well, it's not the most important thing. Mm-hmm. It's just a convenience. So it's one of those things where if you play, even though when you first get to the main game screen, it'll tell you who your council members are, and you can go through the menu and you can see, click on each council member and see what their skills are. If you don't do that, you're not going to know what your skills are at all, so you might be confused when you go into the main game.
Gotcha. Cool. Well, if anyone's interested in trying out Jim's project, it's actually on his portfolio site. If you don't mind us sharing that, we can put we can put a link up on our on the page for this podcast. And basically, if you just click on that link, it will take you to the page. And it's actually using Unity Web Player. So if you install the plugin, and you'll probably be prompted to do so if you don't already have it, you can actually play the game right there in your browser, which is pretty awesome. So. I think that if anyone's interested, they're free to check that out, and maybe they can give you their comments on what they think of the game and ask any questions they might have. I'm sure there's a lot more you could say about the development process and kind of your thinking going into it.
Yeah, I'd love that. I'll take any questions, any sort of comments. Even this sucks. Just let me know why it sucks, so maybe I can fix it.
Right.
If it's one of those sort of comments, but as long as it's constructive.
Yeah, we don't mind criticism, but please make it constructive. it's not enough just to say it sucks, because then we don't know what to fix. So, yeah.
Yep. Exactly. So later this week in Backward Compatible, just to give a little preview, I know I have a quick thought I'm going to be releasing probably later this afternoon, which I guess will be. 3 days prior to you listening to this.
Somewhere in that range, yeah.
Somewhere in that range. I'm going to be talking more about Shadowrun Returns, just kind of giving some thoughts about it, talking about the series itself, maybe a little background for those that are interested in the game. I guess sort of like an informal review, more of an analysis. Chris, I believe you have a feature coming up this week.
Yep, this is my week for the feature. My research right now for my final MFA project that I'm going to be working on next semester has to do with emergent narratives, procedural narratives, all that sort of stuff. I'm kind of honing in my direction for my design. So what I'm going to be doing is sort of giving some sort of talk about something that's going on right now in procedural games, whether it's kind of an overview or whether I'm sort of looking at a particular game that interests me, games that have those emergent procedural elements in their stories. So yeah, I'll sort of be talking about that. Don't know precisely what yet, but it should be good. So it'll be cool.
Cool. Well, we'll be looking forward to that. Although I believe once they listen to this, it should all be posted already, right?
Hopefully. We'll see how that goes. The actual date of the release of the podcast tends to vary a little bit depending on whether any of us have a delay on our articles or if we have to we have too much content, we have to push it back a little bit. But yeah, sometime over the weekend it'll probably have been posted. So yeah, that's what we got coming up.
Okay, cool. Well, we'll all look forward to that. I guess we'll go ahead and sign off. Thanks everybody for listening. This has been Backward Compatible. Please join us on our website, backward-compatible.com. And also, if you've enjoyed listening to this podcast and you're not already subscribed through iTunes or listening through Stitcher, liking us, favoring us on Stitcher, please do so.
We're now, as of recently, we're on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, SoundCloud, and of course we embed our SoundCloud feeds into our website, so you can basically pick your poison and listen to us however you want.
Yep.
Cool. Well, thanks for joining us, everyone. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us which games you've been playing lately, and what you think about them. If you try out Jim's game, let us know what you think of that, too. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.